That is my only goal, I see.
Oh, it has this one?
Yeah.
Maybe.
Let's see, both ways, yeah, it works. You have a switch off? Okay, good.
Great, so thank you for the introduction. It's a great pleasure to be here. I also would like to thank the organizers for the invitation. So in today's presentation, I will share with you our recent efforts trying to understand the effects of dilute magnetic dopants on the functional properties of ferroelectrics. So my talk will have two parts. In the first part, I will basically summarize our works summarize our works on understanding the region of enhanced electromechanical coupling due to dilute dopant aging process. For dilute dopant, I'm mostly talking about dopant concentration, you know, around 5%, in some cases even lower. In the second part, I will focus on the magnetization properties arising from dilute magnetic dopants in ferroelectric materials. So it has been known for a while that, you know, we can substantially improve the electromechanic properties of piezoelectric materials simply by aging the sample, and this idea was probably first demonstrated in Ren's paper a long time ago. In this work, simply by aging barium tungstate single crystal, he could get this very giant strain response to electric field. In this work, he didn't even use doped barium tungstate. He simply took advantage of this trace amount of iron dopants naturally existing in this so-called pure barium tungstate. And this idea was later demonstrated in manganese-doped barium tungstate, and more recently in co-doped BTO ceramics and this potassium sodium niobate ceramics with manganese dopants. One thing that is worth mentioning is, in some cases, simply aging the sample is not enough. In this work, they show that if they just age the sample, they don't get a large strain response. Instead, you need to really apply a polyelectric field during the aging process to realize such a strong strain response. So we can tell the effects of aging by looking at the polarization electric field hysteresis loops. So in many cases, for single crystals, after aging, you will see the hysteresis loop transform from this single loop to this double hysteresis loops, as you can see in these two cases. But for ceramic samples, in many cases, you don't see double hysteresis loops. Instead, you see this pinched and also substantially shifted hysteresis loops. And in this work, they actually carefully, you know, quantified the building electric field in their samples. So the region of enhanced electromechanical coupling was initially explained in the context of symmetry conforming principle in the presence of 90 degree domain walls. And later on, we think probably domain pinning by itself, even in absence of domain walls, can explain this behavior. These two ideas are essentially the same idea. So what happened is those imputed dopants, such as iron and manganese, can form dipolar defects with adjacent oxygen vacancy. And those defect dipoles will align with the bar polarization during the aging process. When we apply an electric field perpendicular to the direction of the defect dipole, the black arrow, we switch the bar polarization, a 90 degree rotation. That's how we get a giant strain change. When we turn off the electric field, the defect dipole will reorient the bar polarization to its original state. And that's why when we apply an electric field again, we can again induce a 90 degree rotation and large strain change. In absence of defect dipoles, this 90 degree rotation will be a one-time phenomena because after the switching, there's no recovery force, the polarization will just stay, in this case, along this x direction. So when you apply electric field along the same direction, we will just get 180 degree domain switching without a very large strain change. So to test this model, we carry out molecular dynamic simulations. In this case, we work on barium titanate using a bond-length model potential parameterized with first principle results. We use this genetic defect dipole model. It is a very simple idea. This defect dipole consists of oppositely charged dummy atoms. We fix those the position of those atoms. This allows us to control the magnitude of defect dipole, and also very easy to control the orientation of defect dipoles. And what I show here is the electric field arising from those defect dipoles. You can see a very typical dipolar electric field. And then we simulate the hysteresis loops with and without dipolar defects. So this is a control experiment. We get this symmetric and isotropic polarization electric field hysteresis loops. But in this case, the dipoles are aligned along the y, minus y direction. So if you look at hysteresis loop, we see a shifted hysteresis loop, which is a signature building electric field. But when we apply electric field along the directions that are perpendicular to the defect dipoles, we get a double hysteresis loops, in this case along x and z. But meanwhile, we have this very large strain response. So we then decided to see, you know, how low doping concentration can go to still maintain this giant electromechanic coupling. In this case, the doping concentration is just about like 0.5%, but still we can get this recoverable, reversible giant strain coupling. So as you can see here, the red line, the orange line is the electric field. Whenever we turn on electric field, you see the giant strain change, which is the black line. And when the field is zero, we see this recovery process. Then the second electric field pulse can again induce a large strain change. And all this strain response is due to a 90-degree polarization rotation driven by either the electric field, external electric field, or the building electric field arising from dipolar defects. So it happens that whenever I publish some works based on molecular dynamics, there are always some reference say, okay, this is a classic model, is it really accurate or is it transferable? But the good thing is, by meanwhile, Ron, I think, has collaborators at UCL, right? And Jacob is working on aged lead titanate. They're using a completely different force field, which is adiabatic core shell model, PZT. This model, of course, is also parameterized with density functional theory calculations. It works really well. It was able to reproduce the whole phase diagram for PZT. And they also use this generic defect dipole model. And for the unaged sample, the defect dipoles are randomly oriented. For the aged samples, the dipolar defects are aligned along the same direction. Then they also look at the hysteresis loops. And they essentially got a similar results. So as you can see, when we apply the electric field, you know, perpendicular to the defect dipole direction, which is the black line, they get this double hysteresis loops. By meanwhile, they see this giant strain response. They also study the effect of doping concentration. They see this clear evolution from a single loop to this pinched loop eventually become a double hysteresis loop. But meanwhile, the energy loss, which is the area, you know, circled by the PE loop, also decreases with doping level. So this is very good. That means, you know, this mechanism is pretty robust. Both MD models lead to the same conclusion. A low doping concentration, probably around like 1%, is enough to induce this reversible giant electrostrain uncoupling. For now, I only talk about electrostrain coupling, which is essentially the piezoelectric coefficient D3. But if you talk with experimentalists who's really using piezoelectric materials in device, they also care a lot about mechanic Q or quality factor, which is the inverse of the mechanic energy loss. Very similar to the yesterday's talk, it was mentioned that electroconductivity and thermal conductivity is a pair of contradicted properties of thermoelectrics, but in this case, the quality factor and the susceptibility or piezoelectric coefficient are also a pair of contradicted properties of piezoelectrics. So we like to work, you know, close to the morphotropic phase boundary where we have this giant susceptibility, But to take advantage of this very soft potential energy surface, but meanwhile, because the potential energy surface is very soft, the dipoles are very easy to get, you know, decorrelated. That's why you have very strong hysteric behavior, therefore high energy loss. That's why you have low coefficient factor, you know, around this MPB region. So the fewer material piezoelectric materials for, you know, application is really the product of this K3, the coupling coefficient and the mechanic Q. So this is really a very beautiful review article about the losses in ferroelectric materials. So if you look at this figure, for PZT, indeed, that's the case. Wherever you have high coupling coefficient, you have low Q3. Wherever you have high Q3, you have low K3. But it turns out that simply by introducing, you know, like 1 to 5% of manganese, we can substantially improve the coefactor while maintaining a very high coupling coefficient. The conventional understanding is those dopants will somehow pin the domain walls, therefore the domain wall motion is considered as the main source of mechanic energy loss, but it also means that, you know, the complex behavior of dopants and defects and their influence on the energy losses are far from being fully understood. I think as a, you know, computational material scientist, one great challenge is it's very hard to predict or calculate mechanic Q from first principles or even with inputs from first principles. So nevertheless, I decided to take a shot. I'm exploring a protocol to quantify mechanic Q with molecular dynamics simulations. So I borrowed some idea from these two papers. They're looking at the mechanic Q of carbon nanotubes and 2D graphene nanoresonators. The main idea is we can add a perturbation to the whole system and then at time zero, and then we can just track the change in kinetic energy and potential energy while conserving the total energy. Then we can get a mechanic Q by feeding the kinetic energy to this formula. So I'd like to show some very preliminary results, and this is what I got for pure lead titanate. When I show those data to my collaborators, who is a device engineer, he is actually very happy about those Q values. They're actually quite reasonable. If you look at the temperature dependence, as expected, when we increase the temperature, you can see the reduction of the mechanic Q, which is correct, which is what you will expect, you know, based on this potential energy surface softening argument. So, and then I look at the composition dependence of mechanic Q of PMPT. Right now, I only have data for like a PMN PT. In this case, the 20% PMN. You can see this substantially reduced Q values. So these are very preliminary data, but I think that they're very important first step to understand the atomistic mechanism of both intrinsic and extrinsic energy losses, because now we can really think about, you know, what will happen to the Q value when we introduce defect dipoles, domain walls, and domain wall pinning, etc. So this is a quick summary for this part. I think with molecular dynamics simulations, we believe we have a pretty good understanding about the effects of aging and dipolar defects and ways to further improve the electromechanical properties of ferroelectric ceramics. I think molecular dynamics simulation definitely offers some opportunities for us to really start and look into all kinds of energy, mechanical energy loss mechanisms in piezoelectrics. So now I'm going to talk about our recent works on understanding the magnetic properties arising from dilute magnetic dopants in ferroelectrics. This is a very old problem. I mean, when I first got involved with this project, I think this is a very boring system, but it turns out to be very complicated with a lot of subtleties. So this work was inspired by some very beautiful experimental works from Durand, who is a postdoc in Ron Cohen's group. As you probably don't know, Ron now has a fully functional wet lab where he has a postdoc doing sample characterizations. So I'm not going to say too many details of the, you know, samples, but what I show here is some very beautiful magnetization, magnetic field hysteresis loops for 1% doped ceramics. So this is a very this suggests a room temperature ferromagnetic, Durand also measured the temperature dependence of magnetization. You can see the reduction of the magnetization with increasing temperature, another good sign of phase transition. Even more interesting, Durand polled samples. The black line is the unpolled sample, the red line is the polled sample. You can see the magnetization becomes higher. Again, it at least suggests some possible magneto-electric coupling mechanism. However, a few days later, he showed me another set of data. In this case, it's almost the same compound, but in this case, it's a single crystal. You got something completely different. It's definitely not a very good room temperature ferromagnetic. Then I look into the literatures, and it turns out that there are a lot of works about like iron doped barytite and manganese doped barytite. Much to my surprise, those experimental data have a large variation. In some cases, they are inconsistent. So I decided to give a historic survey of experimental results here. So this is probably the very first work showing that 5% iron doped BTO ceramics can be ferromagnetic at room temperature. You can see this very nice magnetic MH hysteresis loops. In this study, they synthesized nano rods of tetragonal BTO. What's interesting is, they see this magnetic hysteresis loops when the doping concentration is about like 1 more percent, 1.5 more percent. But when the doping concentration is about 2 more percent, the magnetic property actually becomes worse. It turns out that if you put too much iron into the system, the barytite will transfer to this hexagonal phase. Somehow, the magnetic properties of hexagonal barytite is worse than the magnetic properties of tetragonal barytite, even though in those cases the iron concentration is much higher. And there are some systematic studies about the effects of doping concentrations. So again, it has these very nice hysteresis loops, but I think you just need to focus on this line, which shows the magnetization as a function of doping concentration. The magnetic property or magnetization peaks around like a 4%, but in another set of studies, again, is iron doped barytite, they got something completely different. When the doping concentration is smaller than like 6%, they don't see any magnetic behavior. So to give you a better idea, as you can see here, when the doping concentration is about like between 2% to 6%, they essentially got paramagnetic behavior. From the same group, they also look at the manganese doped barytite. Then they again got something completely different. So in the blue line is the tetragonal phase. And now in this case, for 4% manganese doped barytite, they have a decent magnetic response. So hopefully you can see that there are tons of experimental results, but I don't see a very consistent picture. But all those experimental papers, most of those experimental papers will point to this particular paper when they are trying to justify this long-range magnetic order. Because when you think about it, when you only have like a 2 or 3% magnetic dopant, if those dopants are homogeneously distributed, the distance between dopants are usually around maybe 1.5 nanometers, or the exchange mechanism we know about are pretty short range. It seems there's no way those ion will talk to each other, give you a long range magnetic ordering. So this magnetic power model is very interesting. The idea is, in this system, there are some shallow donor electrons, most likely coming from those oxygen vacancies. And this electron will be confined in a hydrogenic orbital, basic hydrogen-like. And those two magnetic impurities here, those black circles, within this orbital, we'll have this ferromagnetic ordering. To be more specific, each magnetic impurity will actually have this empty ferromagnetic ordering with this localized donor electron. Therefore, all the magnetic